Thank you, guys. That was awesome. Wow, I love it when the Spirit moves, huh? Amen. Amen. Well, it's good to see everyone here today. Seems like I've been on this speaking tour lately. I'm not sure what's going on, but I've been speaking multiple churches, and I am blessed to do that, and I am honored to be here before you. Just stand in, that's all. For Pastor Joe, he's an awesome, awesome man of God, and he's certainly a mentor to me in my life, and I certainly hope that I do him some justice here today. I brought some props with me. I've been known as the prop speaker. I always have props. Those of you men that are in my goji know what this is. You've probably seen him before. But I bring these because they're a symbol to me, personally. They're a symbol of who I am in Christ. I'm a warrior for God. And these symbols here remind me of that often. If you don't believe me, I could show you the scars and the bruises and the times that I've been beat up. I can share countless stories of how many battles I've had to fight in my lifetime. I guess I'm old enough that I could probably share more than most. But you know, I'm not alone. I'm not alone. I look out here and I see a lot of other warriors too. And this should be a symbol to you as well. I mean, I just watched as all of you came up here and became warriors for one. And that's what God's people's about, isn't it? Fighting for the cause. Fighting for each other. When you strike one, you strike all of us. That's what warriors do. They stand up for each other. Boy, you don't know how bad I want to speak about warriorism and how to defeat the enemy. But I'm not sure that's the message God wants me to give you. In the past couple of times I've spoken, when I've been asked, my wife will just automatically blurt out a word like, "Steve, you need to talk about the main event." Oh, okay, let's talk about the main event. And then the second time I was asked to speak at St. Thomas Assembly of God, I said, "I was just asked to speak there again." And she goes, "Oh, you got to speak of the prayer box." In case you don't know, the prayer box is one of the chapters in my book. But this time, when Pastor Joe called me, she didn't have a word. I was shaking in the foundations a little. I love my wife. She saved me. She's a good woman. For you younger guys that are looking for a woman, be sure that she saves your life. And she's a good woman. You're only as good as the woman that's beside you. I can promise you that. She's a great woman. And I love her dearly. But she didn't have a word for me, darn it. So I toiled all week, and I get to like Thursday, and Thursday night I look at her, I said, "So, you know, I kind of forgot to ask you, honey, what do you think about this Sunday?" She goes, "I'm sure whatever God gives you will be good enough." So I guess whatever God gives me is going to be good enough for today. Amen, amen, yes. So last week, as I was at church here in Breakthrough, or I forget what we call prayer time or whatever it is, doesn't matter, right? I was praying, and the Lord reflected me back to a vision I had received years and years ago. And as I was revisiting that vision, the Lord showed me an expansion of that vision, and I'm going to share it with you later. But the purpose of the vision was to show me why we fight. What the purpose is behind fighting. Fighting the battles that we face every day. See, when I accepted Christ as my personal Savior, I took on this duty. Because the Lord says that I'm going to have to die to myself in order for me to gain more of Him. And whenever that happens, There comes this transition period. And it's inevitable that when we have made that dedication to the Lord, a struggle is going to begin. We just can't help it. If you're truly seeking after God, there will be a struggle. And you better know how to battle. You better become a warrior. Whoever tells you that being a Christian is passive, whoever tells you that you have to be a weakling to be a Christian, rebuke them in the name of Jesus. Because it takes a real warrior to become a Christian, to stand for what you believe in, to stand against a culture that tells you this isn't true or this isn't right. Listen, you're going to have to be a warrior when you sign up for this army, the army of Christ. So conflict is inevitable. When we think of battle, I'm going to refer to Ephesians, if you want to follow along, 6:12. Because when we go and fight battles, I think it's very important that we know who we're fighting against. It's not the common man. Oh, that's too easy. It's not an event. It's not a building. It's not a structure. It's not something it's something more. It's more significant. And it's relentless. So in Ephesians 6:12, it clearly defines the enemy we face. And I'm sure you have heard this before. I'm reading out of the Holman version, just because it is what it is. It says, "For our battle is not against the flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the world powers of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in heaven." Man, that's pretty powerful. I made the mistake one time of asking God what the battle looks like. Big mistake. Let me tell you. And I kept asking, like, dear God, what are we walking amongst every day? What does that battle look like? And when he revealed it to me through a vision, I want to tell you something. There wasn't enough room for me to move. Shoulder to shoulder combat, face to face, sword to sword. The noise was deafening. The carnage was unbelievable. It got so crazy that I just thought, I am not moving forward at all. I felt like I was slipping all the time. And finally I cried out, "Where are you, Jesus, in all this?" And I just saw a hand lift up with a sword, and he struck it into the ground. He said, "Enough." And I just saw a shimmering light go across the battlefield, and the enemy just dropped. That should tell us something about the power of Jesus Christ. But let me tell you something. I hope I never see that vision again, because it was overwhelming. I'm just going to tell you. It's good to share. Here's something else you need to know about battles, and it's still found in Ephesians. It also tells us how to fight those battles, does it not? It tells us to train ourselves up. It tells us to get ready. Let's go on with verse 13. This is why you must take up the full armor of God. If you don't notice, this little relic right here is the armor of God. I've laid it down for the day. But it's a reminder of what I'm supposed to put on every day. And it says, "So that you may be able to resist the evil day, and having prepared everything, to take your stand. Stand, therefore, with truth like a belt around your waist, righteousness like armor on your chest, and your feet sandaled with readiness for the gospel of peace. In every situation, take the shield of faith, and with it you will be able to extinguish the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is God's word. With every prayer and request, pray at all times in the Spirit, and stay alert in this with all perseverance and intercession for all the saints. So the Lord kind of gives us an outline of what we're supposed to do in these battles. He tells us who we're facing, and then he says, because of how dangerous it is, you must put on the full armor of God and how that is exercised. Many of you know that I coach men's soccer down at Dickinson College. I'm an assistant coach there. And I got to be honest with you. When I'm preparing those players on a daily basis, I got to tell you, we just don't train for the sake of training. I don't put them out there in the field and say, you know what? We're going to run these wind sprints just for the fun of it. And I want to be honest with you. They don't run them just for the fun of it. They get pretty aggravated pretty quick. But our goal as coaches is to always prepare our players for the battle that they face in the next game that we may play. And just like the Word of God shared with us as Christians, we would share with our men, we would say, listen, we are playing Messiah College, the number one college, the number one team in the country. And these are the things we're going to have to do. This is what you're going to face. And because of that, this is what you're going to have to do. But let me tell you something. If I didn't play before them or put before them a goal, they would never work hard to beat that team. There has to be a reason why. And we sit down every year and establish the reasons why with our team. We'll sit down with them one-on-one and say, what would be your goal for this team? And they would give it to us. And then at the end, when we have collectively met with every player, we come up with this set of goals for the team. Maybe it's to win the conference championship. Maybe it's to go on to the NCAAs. Maybe it's to go on and win a national championship. But whatever it is, we come up with a goal and a reason why. And whenever our players get weary and struggle on the training field and in the games, we remind them of the goal. And the Lord did that for us as well. He told us in the Word to run the race to win the prize. And we got to wonder sometimes what that prize looks like. And those of you that are having your small groups tonight, I have thrown out something for you guys to think about, the prize. But the prize is the purpose, the reason why we fight the battles. And listen, this is what I want to talk about most importantly. Yeah, it's about fighting an enemy. I'm talking to warriors. You know all too much what those battles look like. We watched them as they were represented here at the altars today. But I want to answer the reason, why must we fight all the time? Why can't I just take it easy for a little bit? And I want to tell you why shortly. Because I want to share that vision that the Lord gave me a couple of years ago. Because I was asking God, why, Lord, do I seem to always have to take the hardest route to get to the end result? I don't understand. The quickest way between two points is a straight line, Lord. And you always have me winding around up and down hills and through valleys and wildernesses and deserts. I don't get it. Can't I just go straight to the point? I don't understand. Why, Lord, would you put me through this? Why, Lord, do you put your people through it? So one day in prayer, as I was praying, I found myself standing on the edge of this beautiful garden. It had row after row of manicured gardens. It was surrounded by a hedgerow, and the hedges were as tall as this, the walls are here around our building. And I stood and I watched. I was on the very far edge. There was a hedgerow right, I was up against the back of the hedgerow, and I could follow it on both sides. I watched it as it went around, and I thought, wow, this is protected. And I noticed movement on the other side of the hedgerow, and I could just see these helmets every once in a while moving, and I realized it was the army of Christ. Not only did I have a hedgerow protecting that garden, but on the other side of that hedgerow, there were soldiers marching around and securing the area. And as my eyes started to make their way around that hedgerow, I noticed a gate. A wrought iron, black wrought iron gate. You know, the ones with the bars, with the old mortise lock that had the skeleton key that goes into it. Can you guys visualize that? And it was hanging wide open. And as I started to walk over, I thought, wow, man, between every row of plants, which were, by the way, perfectly placed in a perfect line, straight line, row to row, in between every row was a perfectly manicured strip of grass, allowing me to walk up and down those rows. It's kind of like one of those most beautiful vineyards you'd ever see kind of thing. And as I started to drift over to that gate, I noticed a man standing there. And as I walked over to the gate, I realized it was Jesus. And he was standing watch at that gate. And I said, Lord, what is this? He says, this is your garden. This is your garden. And I turned, and it was kind of odd, I must say. Where I just came from, I could see fully grown trees bearing fruit. And then I noticed that there were several rows where the trees weren't quite mature yet. Then I found other rows that just had the little seedlings popping up. And I started to put one and two together. I'm like, wow, that's kind of significant. What am I looking at? He goes, that's you. This is your garden. This is your place. You earned it. I'm like, oh my gosh. I said, what about the gate? He said, oh, you must be careful though. Be careful that you don't let anything in here that could destroy it. That's why there's a gate. And I thought, then why have a gate? Close me in and just keep me there. I'm good. I don't need to go back out there. I don't want to see what those soldiers are keeping from coming in. I'm good with right here. And I'm like, why is there a gate? Then I realized. He said, if you think for 1 minute that fruit's for you, you're crazy. You're bearing fruit for others. I thought, wow. That's so cool. So this garden is to be shared. This garden is for others to walk in, to use it up. I'm going to labor and serve so others can use it up. And there was a peace about that, I must say. But the Lord kept warning me, careful who you let in, though. Be careful. It only takes one weed to gobble up all that was planted. So I thought about that a little bit. And as I kind of let it go, I kind of realized, okay, that vision is for me personally. It's about the garden. And I understood that I had to keep watch. And then last week, as I was praying, this warrior of me, I was getting a little tired. All right? I was tired. I was tired of fighting battles every day. I was being used up. I kept thinking about the last 5 or 6, 7 years of my life that has been turned upside down. All for good. Don't get me wrong. All for good. But how many of you know that whenever Christ turns you upside down and the Holy Spirit starts to just blow up inside of you, the human body has trouble keeping up? another battle, another struggle. And I got to be honest with you, last Sunday I was just like, man, Lord, what has this developed in my life? And you know what I found? I found myself back in the garden. This time, it had expanded. This time, I saw rows and row after row after row of tilled soil, rich in nutrients. I could tell it was ready for planting, but it hadn't been planted yet. And I could see row after row after row, and I'm like, good golly, man. My garden has grown. And I sensed the Lord smiling down on me and goes, yep, that's what has been happening in the struggles. The struggles that you have been facing these last couple of years. That's what's happening in your life, in the struggles you're facing every day. See, he showed me something that day. Battles are meant to hold ground. Hallelujah. Battles are meant to take ground. We take it. The Lord didn't call us to go sit still. He said, come, follow me. That means go. Go somewhere. You're not going to sit still. You have to take ground. And there's a purpose for taking ground. And it's more than just the physical nature of just taking something, but it serves a purpose. When you take ground, your garden grows. Ground gain builds perseverance through faith. And in the end, maturity in our relationship with Christ. James 1:24. I'm sorry, 1:2-4. Consider it great joy, my brothers, whenever you experience various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance, but endurance must do its complete work so that you may be mature and complete, lacking nothing. See, I'm convinced that when we face battles, we have a choice. We can have a spirit of retreat, and we can have a spirit of just laying down, but we can have a spirit of saying, you know what? Why am I going through this, Lord? There has to be a purpose. And when you realize what your prize is, what the prize is in your personal life, because I think the prize is personal to each of us. It's becoming the fullness of who you are. What God whispered in your ear and said, I need you to be this before I was even formed in the womb. I'm seeking that prize. And whenever he calls us to do that, he says, but you're going to go through some struggles and battles because I have to mold you into being that thing. Without the scars, without the experience, becoming who he wants me to be is empty. It's empty. I think when you take ground, we get correction through the battles. We don't like hearing that, do we? Hebrews 12:7-11. Endure it as discipline. God is dealing with you as sons. For what son is there whom father does not discipline? But if you are without discipline, which all receive, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Furthermore, we had natural fathers discipline us, and we respected them. Shouldn't we submit even more to the Father of the spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time based on what seemed good to them, but he does it for our benefit so that we can share his holiness. No discipline seems enjoyable at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it yields the fruit of peace and righteousness to those who have been trained by it. You know, I almost did not put this in here because I feared that you guys would misunderstand what I'm trying to say about discipline. I'm not talking about beat you down, set you in the corner, put your nose on the board kind of thing. What I'm talking about is being disciplined enough so when you go through the fire, you're going to be disciplined to do it the right way. You won't be afraid to step out and do it the way God wants you to do it. When you fight your battles and you are on your knees praying all the time, over and over again, the Lord starts to develop this thing in us that allows us to become more mature, as I said earlier. But there's times when we make the mistakes when we start to rely on ourselves instead of Him and standing on that faith. And the Lord sometimes goes, you know what, you have a free will, you're going to make that choice. However, when you do that, this is what's going to happen. And through that, we become more disciplined. We go, I'm not going to do that again. We always talk to our players about being disciplined on the field. Not to lash out when someone takes you out from behind. And I know the group of individuals that I have at our school, and we talk about, you know, being role models and mentors for those that are around us. I always say, be careful how you act in tough situations, that you don't lash out because they're watching you. Everyone's watching you. So through those tough times and those times you get bit in the heel, as we call it in soccer, you have to respond the right way. And I got to be honest with you. I didn't for a long time. And the Lord disciplined me over it. And I learned through seeking God in those situations that I had to deal with it in a different way, with a different heart. Discipline is not designed to beat you down so much as it is to train you up and to respond in situations in a better disciplined way. I like this one. The ground gain becomes the proving grounds of our faith, does it not? When you're in these battles and you struggle, you got one of two things to do. You either try to figure it out on your own, or you put it all on Jesus and say, listen, man, you got to take control of this. You do. It's simple. As Christians, we have two choices. And whenever you say, I relinquish control and I give it to you, the proving ground of your faith, the proving ground of what you have said and done and put into practice shows up in your garden. See, here's the thing. I think that the proving grounds of our faith, the ground better gained also creates an environment where the Lord says, I'm expanding your garden because of your battles. And He starts to till up this new soil. And He starts to put in new rows to your garden. And as He does that, guess who enters in? The Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit starts to pour down all the gifts that God promises us. They're the fruits. The fruits that hang off the trees in your garden. And as the gates open and you let those in, that God says, I need them to experience this. I need them to walk through your garden. I need you to make an impact on that person's life. They start to partake of the gifts that was given to you through the battles that you fought. So I guess the message today for you is this. When you guys face a battle, understand that there's a common good for it. Understand that the battle is more than just the carnage and the hand-to-hand combat. Understand that the battles you face and the battles you partake in are for a purpose. They are for you to develop into what God wants you to be. He will never give you more than you can handle. Never. And He will always be by your side. And listen, the Lord fights for you every day. You're not in this by yourself. He goes before you. And I'm serving notice right now that God is winning. He's not holding ground. He's winning for you. He's taking over. Can you imagine the battles you face without him? Think about that. Go home and say, "Dear God, what would this battle look like if you didn't even come in and help me with this?" I'm afraid that there would be more losses in the loss column than wins. Listen, we serve a God who's winning, not losing. Join along with him. Lock arms with Christ. Go through the struggles. It's well worth it. I promise you the soil in your garden will be tilled and nurtured by his own hands. And he will take the seed and he will plot it in the property, in the ground, and he will allow it to grow. He will honor your fight. He will honor your fight and allow your garden to grow. And the more you fight, and the more you win, the more you become who God wants you to be. Listen, I hope to see every one of you stand along my side when I see my Savior in heaven. And I say, "Dear God, I fought the good fight. And I have become who you've asked me to be. The last breath I took on earth, the revelation hit me. I didn't fight in vain. You used me for what you needed me to be. And I stand before you a worn warrior, but I gotta tell you, I loved every minute of it. Because I'm gonna stand before my God and I'm gonna tell him, I fought tooth and nail for you, dear God. And I'm crawling to you probably hands and knees because I'm wore out. But I want my garden to be huge. I want my tree limbs to be dangling like if they're ready to snap, full of fruit. And I hate to say this, but the only way we get there is through the trials and tribulations and the struggles that this world seems to put us through. And you have a choice. Stand up and be a warrior. Or sit down and let someone else do the work. Listen, I'm here to tell you we're winning the battle. Don't listen to those voices. They don't understand. It says so in the Bible, right? It says they don't understand. Don't listen to them. Don't be discouraged. Persevere. Pray for endurance. Pray for courage. Pray for those things, those utensils, those tools, those weapons that you need. I challenge you every day to wake up and say, "Dear God, let's put the armor on. I am a warrior for you today. And I will take ground." From a child to the oldest adult in here, you're warriors. And you will take ground. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for the move of the Spirit in this building. It's been so awesome, dear God, that you come down and you surround us in your Holy Spirit. Dear Lord, I pray for each one of these individuals in this room right now that you will fill them, dear God, with the Holy Spirit. And better yet, dear God, you will surround them with your guardian soldiers. That, dear Lord, that you will give them the strength, the endurance, the courage, the strength, the wisdom and the knowledge to go out and fight against the enemy on a daily basis. Lord, I impart on them a vision that they can see the garden that they have created through the struggles and the battles that they have had to come up against, dear God. I pray, dear God, that they will see the fruits of their labor, the fruits of their struggles, and the fruits of their battles, dear God. Lord, I pray that you will never leave or forsake them, because I know you won't. But let their eyes be sensitive and their ears be sensitive to see who you are and what you're doing in their life, to hear your voice each and every day. Let them be guided by the Holy Spirit, dear Lord. Let them be strong, dear God. Let them win the battles. Let them know that you're winning battles for them too, dear God. We praise you, dear God, for what you're doing in our lives. We praise you for winning the battles, dear God. I'm sorry that I don't admit that enough. I don't proclaim that enough, but you're winning the battles, dear God, and I thank you for it. I thank you, dear God, for isolating us from the real carnage that's out there. And I thank you for going before us and destroying enemies that we know we can't do on our own. I praise your holy name, dear God, and I pray your blessings over these people as they depart and go home. Give them safe travels, dear Lord, and an awesome week, dear God. Let them take ground in Jesus' name. Amen.